Valley Board of Commissioners of October 24th to order. Roll call, please.
Brotham?
Here.
McGuire is absent.
Moran?
Here.
Ortega?
Aye.
Reinhardt?
Here.
Jean?
Here.
And Martinson?
Here. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. I'm going to turn to Commissioner Ortega for our land acknowledgement this morning.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Every community owes... Am I on?
You are.
Thank you.
Every community owes its existence and vitality to generations from around the world who contributed their hopes, dreams, and energy to making the history that led to this moment. Some were brought here against their will. Some were drawn to leave their distant homes in hope of a better life. And some have lived on this land since time immemorial. Truth and acknowledgement are critical to building mutual respect and connection across all barriers of heritage and difference. We are standing on the ancestral lands of the Dakota people. We want to acknowledge the Ojibwe, the Ho-Chunk, and the other nations of people who also call this place home. We pay respects to their elders, past and present. Please take a moment to consider the treaties made by the tribal nations that entitle non-Native people to live and work on traditional Native lands. Consider the many legacies of violence, displacement, migration, and settlement that brings us together here today. And please join us in uncovering such truths at any and all public events.
Thank you, Commissioner Ortega. We have the agenda of October 24th presented for approval. Is there a motion?
Second.
We have a motion and second. Any discussion? Seeing none, roll call, please.
Ortega?
Aye.
Reinhardt?
Aye.
Jean?
Aye.
Brotham?
Aye.
McGuire is absent. Moran?
Aye.
And Martinson?
Aye. We have the minutes from October 17th, 2023 presented for approval. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and second. Any discussion? Seeing none, roll call, please.
Ortega?
Aye.
Reinhardt?
Aye.
Jean?
Aye.
Brotham?
Aye.
McGuire is absent. Moran?
Aye.
And Martinson?
Aye. Next, we have our proclamation for Domestic Violence Awareness Month. Commissioner Jean will be presenting the proclamation this morning, and folks from our domestic violence prevention groups are here. If you join us, welcome. Shelly Klein, we see Shelly and her work in the community, and we're so glad you're here with us today.
Okay, it's okay. All right. Chair Martinson, Board, Ramsey County Board Commissioners, Chair, County Manager. Okay. Like, what am I thinking? Okay. All right. Yes. Pleased to be here. I have the privilege today to present us with a proclamation recognizing Domestic Violence Awareness Month in Ramsey County. This is one that's very important to us as a body, as well as myself personally, just knowing the data that we know about that one in three women have experienced domestic violence in their life. That means we all know someone. So I bring to you all this proclamation with a heavy heart, remembering both the survivors and victims, as well as the kids in the families who have been impacted, as well as our communities. So I'm happy to present this proclamation with Shelly Klein from St. Paul Ramsey County Domestic Violence Intervention Prevention Program. I'll get the name spit. So I will read the proclamation. Whereas domestic violence is a pattern of behavior used to gain or maintain power and control over an intimate partner. and that domestic abuse and all forms of systems of oppression must be eliminated. And whereas domestic violence involves physical, sexual, psychological, and economic abuse, intimidation, and isolation, and happens to one in every three women in their lifetime. And whereas domestic violence touches the lives of people of all ages, backgrounds, genders, and gender identities, sexual orientations, spiritual beliefs, and circumstances when a home becomes a place of hopelessness and terror, and leaves in its wake a myriad of loss throughout our community, including mental and physical injury, homelessness, substance abuse, impact on the entire community. And whereas we voice compassion and pledge action for the families, friends, and communities that have experienced the anguish of domestic violence, as at least 20 women and one man in Minnesota were killed by a current or former intimate partner in 2022, and at least three bystanders lost their lives during a domestic violence incident. And whereas we further voice our compassion and commitment for the 52 children, 31 of whom were minor children in Minnesota, who lost their mother in their past year due to domestic violence, in which 16 of them were present at the time of murder or discovery of her body. And whereas Ramsey County is a recognized national leader for its groundbreaking response to domestic violence and will continue its endless resolve to confront domestic violence at all levels and support victims and their children, and the efforts of our community-based advocacy programs, public health workers, county attorney's office, community corrections, emergency communications, and sheriff office. And whereas we honor the pioneering work of community-based advocates who founded the nation's first shelter, have been instrumental in the creation of national models that reduce domestic violence and homicides, and have implemented culturally relevant approaches and responses. And whereas, as a county, we acknowledge that solutions to end domestic violence will only happen with the commitment of our entire community to ensure the safety of victims, and in working tirelessly with our community-based partners in realizing an equitable and violence-free community for all. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed, the Ramsey County Board of Commissioners declares October 2023 as Domestic Violence Awareness Month in Ramsey County. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Zhang.
And with that, I'll present it over to Executive Director Shelley Klein from SPIP.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Good morning, Shelley.
Good morning. I appreciate the county board doing this every year. It means so much to our agency and to our community. I stand here as one person today. My coworkers are all busy, as my sister programs are. None of this would not be possible without a community-wide effort. Each year, we serve over 6,000 victims of domestic violence, and the women and children and men we work with are incredible. And I often remind people that when we do lose people, we have to remember the lives that are saved. And the county board, and I say this from my heart, has been a wonderful, wonderful advocate for victims of domestic violence. And your efforts, when you sit here today, you don't get to see what I see. The women and the children that come to us battered, frightened, scared, we reach out in the middle of the night, we go to their homes, and we work with them, and we work with them on safety plans. It could be for weeks, it could be for years. But you're a part of going into those houses. You're a part of holding those hands. You're a part of working with their children, and you're a part of saving those lives. And I thank you for that.
Thank you, Shelley. Commissioner Reinhart.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Well, I was really pleased to be able to be at the event last night and hearing from County Attorney Choi, Mayor Melvin Carter, City Council Member Rebecca Naker, and our own chair, Chair Martinson, along with a courageous woman talking about her experience. I also had the opportunity last week, the White Bear Chamber had a ribbon cutting at the Northeast Youth and Family Services in White Bear Lake for some renovations and updates that they had done to the facility. And I commented at the time that I was there for the first groundbreaking and ribbon cutting, because I had received services, my kids had received services through what was then the White Bear Lake Area Counseling Center. They did an exercise that I thought was really meaningful, and they said, okay, they handed out a piece of paper and a pen, and they said, write down your deepest, darkest secret on that piece of paper. So everybody kind of looked at her and went, well, okay, maybe. and so most of the people wrote something down. And then she said, okay, now that you've got it written down, now pass them forward. And yeah, the gasps in the room were like, what? And she said, okay, I'm not really asking you to pass them forward. What I'm trying to express to you is what it feels like when somebody makes that first phone call. And they are turning their deepest, darkest secrets over to someone that they do not know, but they have to trust. Mm-hmm. And then she did also say, so how many actually wrote down something and who didn't? But the fact is, it really made you think mm-hmm. about how difficult that first phone call is to make. Mm-hmm. And that you're putting your hands, your life in someone else's hands, whether it's about domestic violence or issues with children. There are so many things that there's help out there. And I guess that's my main point here, is that there's help. Mm-hmm. I also shared then what, it wasn't what I had written on the piece of paper, because I didn't actually write down my deepest, darkest secret. But I did want to share with them that what is not my deepest, darkest secret, right. Because I know that when you talk about it, it helps others. And that is the fact that Ramsey County, specifically Ramsey County Commissioner Bob Worth, saved my life mm-hmm. and my kids' lives, because he said that there was a program that I needed to go to, and it was about domestic violence, and I went to it, and I'm here today because of that.
Yeah.
And my kids. And I tell that story so that people understand that it doesn't matter who you are,
right.
Where you're at, you get to the point where you're so beaten down, you think you are worthless, mm-hmm. and you need to reach out.
Yeah.
And I guess that's all I can say. You need to reach out. So I wanted to share that again, because I think people need to understand what goes on and how... You know, I've heard people say, well, why didn't you just leave? Mm-hmm. Because you're too scared.
That's right.
And you don't know what's going to happen. You don't know. You literally are afraid for your life.
That's right.
But with help, you can.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't like to think of myself as a victim, but as a survivor.
Mm-hmm.
And it was because of the tools that I received. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Reinhart. Yeah, Commissioner Ortega.
Well, Madam Chair, I just want to say congratulate Shelley. I know she's been doing this work, got to be for over 30 years, because it was before I got in office that we worked together. How many years have you been doing this?
It's been probably 35 since passing.
Yeah. So I just want to highlight the fact that, you know, her leadership in the community going back all those years has brought us to this point. And I just want to highlight your good work that you've done for all the communities.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you, Commissioner Ortega. Commissioner Moran.
Thank you, Madam Chair. First, Commissioner Reinhart, thank you. Thank you for sharing your story, because it really makes a difference in so many others who are scared to be vulnerable like that and to say, I need help. So thank you so much for sharing your story. To Shelley, just want to say thank you for your many, many years of service and work and dedication to this field, to this area, where you are, really saving women, children, and sometimes men's lives, right? I was just sitting here reflecting innerly because this is a heavy, heavy subject. And it's always heavy for me to hear and deal and to be response to incidents where someone has been hurt or when someone has been murdered or when someone's in the hospital or someone has died. It's always heavy for me. And often I shy away from those type of encounters because how emotionally I feel with incidents like that. And I truly believe that's why I'm such a prevention person. I want to go upstream and stop and prevent things from happening. And, you know, and we need both ends of that continuum to be in place. And I just want to share, you know, if there is some things through your work and through your experience over the year, over the years that we can do upstream to support and help or whatever that may look like for the women and children, men and families, please share those things too, because it's important that we are able to prevent such crisis from happening, right? And give them an escape route or, you know, a number or whatever. And I know you do a lot of things around prevention, but, you know, there's always more, I guess, that we can do. But thank you so much for your service.
Thank you, Commissioner Moran. And, you know, as you mentioned that, I think it's important for us to lift up and mention that there is a critical need in funding. The number of folks that are receiving services has increased drastically post-pandemic. We've seen more violence, more death, more homicides because of domestic violence. And the impact isn't just on the victims and their families, but the whole community and our law enforcement community. We've seen more law enforcement officers die serving a warrant or a restraining order related to domestic violence or responding to calls. So the impact and the danger is extremely high and has increased in the last couple years. And the state didn't fund it fully, programs. And so we've added it to our legislative agenda to continue to advocate and lift up to get resources because our advocates are working 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, and we need more of them, and we need to make sure that we can pay them living wages. So I wanted to just lift that up to Commissioner Reinhart.
Madam Chair, I neglected to say something that I really needed to say, and that is that I was talking about my first marriage. And in fact, JP always says, please make that clear. Because tomorrow we are celebrating our 32nd wedding anniversary.
That's right. Well, happy anniversary.
Thank you.
That's it. Thank you, Commissioner Reina. And thank you again. We're going to do a picture, shall we?
Yes. I'd like to invite the rest of the commissioners over here for a photo, please. And now we're going to move to our administrative items, and I'm going to turn to Commissioner Ortega.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Item number four, property tax abatement. Approve the property tax abatements and any penalties and interest with a reduction of $10,000 or more. Item number five, property acquisition of Ogden Avenue, St. Paul, Minnesota. Item number six, Rice Street Local Road Improvement Program grant application. Did you want to pull that?
No. Okay. I'm just celebrating.
I thought there was a sign language. Item number 7, request for funds for the Adult Detention Center for Housing, Transportation, and Food Service. Item number 8, agreement with the City of Lauderdale for voting equipment and election services. Item number 9, single source agreement with Cyclo Media Technology, Inc. for street level imagery services and software. Item number 10, salary schedule and grade for Division Director of Finance classified position. Item number 11, Operation Green Light for Veterans.
Second.
Excellent. Thank you. We have a motion and second. Roll call, please.
Ortega?
Aye.
Reinhardt?
Aye.
Zhang?
Aye.
Fratham?
Aye.
McGuire is absent. Moran?
Aye.
And Martinson?
Aye. We'll go back to item number 7, request for funds for the Adult Detention Center for Housing, Transportation, and Food Service.
Move approval.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. Commissioner Reinhardt.
Madam Chair, I wanted to pull this so that we could highlight it. We had commented earlier this year that there were costs that were going up in the jail, and we wanted to make sure that we cover those and working with the Sheriff's Office. And so this is really about covering the cost of housing individuals in custody at other county facilities, and that was in response to the Minnesota Department of Corrections population limits. Also, budget for increased cost of transportation, and let's see here, and the food service. That was the other one that was really, that had gone up unexpectedly in that particular case. But anyhow, so I wanted to point out that those are the things that this is about. We've had a lot of discussion about the sheriff's budget, obviously, and I wanted to point out that these are things that we wanted to make sure that we covered, that it was very clear where these costs were coming from. And so I thought it was worth pulling so that we could acknowledge that, yes, there were added costs and that we are covering them.
Excellent. Thank you, Commissioner Reinhardt. County Manager O'Connor, and I see the sheriff is here. So, Sarah Fletcher, if you'd like to come to the podium, you're welcome. We don't get your presence often, so I want to recognize that, too.
Is it optional? Madam Chair, Commissioner Reinhardt, and I'll let the sheriff back clean up if there's anything he wants to add with his team. Thanks for the comments, Commissioner Reinhardt. I definitely agree. Just for tracking purposes and within our budget conversations more broadly, I wanted to highlight a couple dynamics. The food service piece here is an inflationary cost on the contract within the food budget. That's going to be an ongoing implication. It is addressed in the 24-25 budget proposal as proposed in the county's budget. So I wanted to highlight that and say we knew a year ago that that part was going to happen, even as the contract got changed. And for commissioners who have sat around this table, food service in that environment has been challenging for many years at this point in time for a variety of different reasons. The other two costs here related to boarding and transportation are more unique to the current period that we're in due to the DOC temporary licensing order that we've been under. They've been back on site. We anticipate getting news at some point going forward. I don't have a specific date, so if the sheriff knows anything else he can share there, he can. But before the end of the year, I anticipate hearing more, and hopefully that would remove this inflationary pressure looking the way that it does going forward. There's as you move forward through the rest of the year, the one other spot I want to highlight that's not here but is a part of ongoing inflationary pressure conversation relates to trial backlogs and the implication for court security that impacts the sheriff's office as well. We address that on the front end with the county attorney's office because they need to have attorneys to be able to even do cases. But on the back end, what you see is the security needs and that cost. There's a ARPA, just like we did earlier, we did a cleanup once before. There's gonna be a second cleanup before the end of the year. And I just wanted to highlight that we intentionally broke these pieces apart so it's easier to track them as we go.
Thank you, County Manager O'Connor. Chair Fletcher, I want to give you the mic.
Well, I just want to thank Alex and Ryan for some heavy lifting and hard work that's gone on to get these numbers nailed down. Of course, Kyle and our office work closely with them, but none of these figures would be accurate without Alex's work, and so thank you for that. Regarding the inspection, we did complete our inspection. Inspector Whistler is here. He's been working closely with the Department of Corrections. We have heard verbally that we passed the inspection, and we expect a notification in the next couple weeks.
The inspection is complete. It's on the commissioner's desk for his review and approval.
Commissioner of Corrections. And at that point, we'll begin transitioning the inmates that we have housed at other places back here. And by the first of the year, maybe sooner, yeah, that will be complete. But we can't do it all in one day, obviously, nor do we want to. So this, as Ryan pointed out, this figure won't apply to next year's budget. And thank you to the board for your kind comments on putting it in perspective as to what we're dealing with here.
Thank you, Sheriff Fletcher. Any other comments? All right, then we'll move to roll call, please.
Ortega?
Aye.
Reinhardt?
Aye.
Zhang?
Aye.
Brotham?
Aye.
McGuire is absent. Moran?
Aye.
And Martinson?
Aye. Next, we'll move to Operation Green Light for Veterans.
So moved.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion, a second. I have pulled this item because this is a really awesome opportunity. We have a resolution here around Operation Greenlight. We've talked about this before, but it is about highlighting the services, our County Veteran Service Officer who is here, and Christina, if you want to come up. And we also have Charlie Hammond from Representative McCollum's office here today. Representative McCollum has introduced a bipartisan resolution on the House in Congress. It may or may not ever have a vote, depending on what's happening. But in the meantime, we are moving forward. And this is a national initiative, Operation Greenlight. You all have green light bulbs here. You can put them in your offices or take them home to display during the month of November, but especially November 6th through the 12th. I'm going to turn it over to Christina.
Thank you, Chair Martinson. Good morning, Chair Martinson, Commissioners, County Manager O'Connor. Christina Rost with Veteran Services. I just wanted to call up. I did invite some veterans and their families. If you guys want to come up,
yes,
please. And Charlie, come up too. So as they're walking up, you guys can just... So just a quick little overview of what Operation Greenlight is. It's an initiative led by the NACO, the National Association of Counties, and the National Association of County Veteran Service Officers, to encourage all counties, parishes, and boroughs to show support for veterans by lighting public buildings in green lights from November 6th to November 12th. In addition to lighting buildings, residents and businesses are also encouraged to participate, even simply by changing one light bulb to green. By shining a green light, county governments and our residents will let veterans know that they are seen, appreciated, and supported. Also participating in Operation Greenlight shows our county's commitment and support to veterans and their families. It's an opportunity to raise awareness of the unique challenges faced by many veterans as they transition out of the active military service, and it highlights the important resources available from the county, state, and federal levels to assist the veterans and their families. I'm gonna invite Charlie Hammond up from Congressman McCollum's office to share a letter.
Thank you. Commissioners, Madam Chair, the letter to read in support of this resolution from Congressman McCollum. Dear Commissioners, thank you for the opportunity to address today's board meeting regarding Operation Greenlight for Veterans. I regret that I'm unable to join you in person, but I would like to share my support for this important program. Our nation owes a debt of gratitude to the brave U.S. service members who defend and protect our nation and its ideals at home and abroad. Operation Greenlight for Veterans not only encourages county governments to illuminate buildings with green lights from November 6th to November 12th, to symbolize unwavering support, appreciation, and recognition for veterans, but it also helps connect veterans with vital county resources to help them thrive in their daily lives. I thank the National Association of Counties, including NACO Military and Veterans Policy Committee Chair and Ramsey County Commissioner Trista Martinson, for their leadership. I urge my colleagues in the U.S. House to join me in supporting my bipartisan resolution, House Res 750, honoring this intergovernmental partnership to demonstrate our commitment to veterans in our communities. Thank you for your critical work that you do to raise awareness about important county resources available to help veterans transition to civilian life. Excellent. Thank you.
Thank you, Charlie. Thank you.
Real quickly, too, I want to invite David, one of our veterans, up.
Yes.
And his wife. Just to share a little bit about the support he's received from county resources.
Yes.
Thanks, Christine.
Good morning.
First of all, we'd like to thank you guys for having us here. And I would like to thank my wife, Jackie, for being there for me and supporting me. And without her faith in God, none of this would be possible. That's God. But with that said, Christina has been there for us, and so has Ramsey County. Over the last 4 or 5 years, Christina has personally worked arduously with me and my family to get us through the loopholes of the government. She's answered every call. She's been there day and night. She's, it's just amazing. I mean, I try to tell everyone that will listen that when I run into veterans, I tell them, hey, there's people out there for you. I usually give Christina's number, so I'm sure she gets a lot of calls. But my dad, I'd be remiss if I didn't say this. My father's name is David Hall. He was the director of the Black Veterans of America. Stationed out of Ramsey County. So you guys also helped my father for 20 years run an organization that helped the veterans receive their benefits, get housing, get glasses, get dental. Just the list just goes on and on. And their families. We have 5 kids. Christina, about 3 weeks ago, we had been fighting to get my 100% through the military, and it was a 20-year fight. I was granted that 100% about 3 weeks ago, and I was at home, and Christina just called me out the blue personally to tell me the news. You know, before even the government notified me, Christina called me. She said, David, you know, I was like, well, what's up? She was like, well, I got some news for you. When she gave me the news, I mean, I couldn't say anything less but me want. I did break down on my knees and prayed on it because it helps me, it helps my family, it helps my kids. And, I mean, I can go on and on. Ramsey County's done a lot for me, done a lot for my family, done a lot for friends of mine, done a lot for other veterans. Without you guys, man, you guys got to take this home. There's veterans out here suffering. And I want to drive that home. The suffering, they don't know that this help is here. So this Operation Green Light, whatever you guys can do to get this initiative out, we got to let people know that there are people out there like Christina that's willing to help you, willing to answer your calls, willing not to judge you. This part is personal to me because my wife went through it with me, but so did Christina. I was up at St. Cloud in the hospital for a while, and Christina talked to me personally, you know, through that time, talked to my wife during that time. That's not Christina's job to have to do that, to take personal calls and to ask about my family. So I want to say thank you again. You mean the world to us. I want to thank you guys. And I do, I just got to drive home how important this is for other veterans. You know, because definitely we're in good shape, but there's a lot of veterans that aren't. So thanks again for your time.
Thank you so much, David. Jackie, thank you.
Thanks, David. That is the kind of support you will get from all of our CVSOs, our County Veteran Service Officers in our department. So
yeah,
these three are CVSOs, and then we have other veterans from Ramsey County as well to represent. And Mr. Hammond, if you could extend our gratitude and our thanks to Congresswoman McCollum for supporting Operation Greenlight for veterans. Thank you, Chair Martinson. I was going to say Commissioner McGuire, but she's missing. Commissioners, County Manager O'Connor, and Ramsey County for your unwavering support, appreciation, and recognition of all veterans and their families within our community.
Excellent. So, thank you. I would love if you all would introduce yourselves, because we want to know who you are and where you work. So if you would, Patrick, we'll start on your end. You've done this before.
I'm Pat Chapman, the County Assessor.
Oh, and what branch did you serve?
I was a U.S. Army.
All right.
Cody Hillstead, Project Manager, Army National Guard.
Excellent. Lois Cheesbrough, I'm Planning Manager in Social Services, and I'm a veteran of the Army.
Excellent. Cedric Lattimore, Withdrawal Management.
And Cedric, did you serve? What branch?
Marine Corps.
Semper Fi. Hoorah.
Alex Fleming, Air Force. I work with Ramsey County Veteran Services.
Good morning, everyone. Michael Ellisher, active duty with Air Force, long lines of my family, Navy and Army as well.
Excellent.
And a County Veteran Service Officer.
Jim Norton, Ramsey County Veteran Services, 14 years, Army National Guard.
Excellent. Thank you all so much. And you probably know I'm a veteran myself. I served in the Navy active duty, then the Marine Corps, and then the Army National Guard. So 16 years in active duty. So thank you for your service in the military and home.
Madam Chair, that was one of the things I wanted to make sure that you were recognized for and all the work that you've done. I also want to note that one of the reasons I assume you were thanking Commissioner McGuire is because the National Association of Counties, which she is now president of, is in support of the Greenlight Project and has really been promoting it across the country. And so I just wanted to raise that up, and that's partly because of you know, what we have done here in Ramsey County and trying to really make this something that people understand is important to recognize, but also to help. And that's, I appreciate your story, because that's absolutely true. Hopefully there are people that are listening now and will go, I didn't realize that. And they make that call.
Exactly. Thank you, Commissioner Reinhart. County Manager O'Connor.
Thanks, Madam Chair. I know it's not a proclamation, but Ann, if you want to come up, you can grab a picture. And as you come up, I would just say Commissioner McGuire would have been here today to send her regards, but she had her flight canceled on her late last night from a NACO business thing, and she's doing the flight hopping around the country today. So I can assure you, she would rather be here.
Yes. Commissioner Moran.
So real quickly, because there may be someone here watching that need this information, can you share what the information? Yes. What's the number? What's the website or something that can be helpful?
Yeah, any veteran or family member can reach us by calling 651-266-2545.
2545.
And you can always call 651-266-8500. You'll catch a navigator. We will get you to Veteran Services.
That's right.
It's the only number you have to remember. And if you want to go direct to that, to Christina's number in Vet Services, that works as well.
Or 452545.
And it's important for veterans to understand that services are free. There's no cost. We are there to help veterans receive their benefits. They should not seek someone that is asking for payment to get their benefits or to take a part of their benefits. There are predators out there seeking to get finances from veterans. So it is a free service with the county and the County Veterans Service Office. It's really important. I'm going to ask all the commissioners to join in the picture with the veterans. You can bring your green light as a prop. And we're going to use this in our social media campaign over the next couple weeks as well. So we're going to, you want to join us?
Sure. If you want to fit in, you can take McGuire.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sure.
And Madam Chair.
Yes, Commissioner.
I know we said if somebody needs help, but the fact of the matter is if you're a veteran, it doesn't hurt to call.
That's right.
Because there are a lot of things that are out there that right. veterans don't necessarily know. There's things with property tax. There's all
right.
kinds of different options out there. And so if you're a veteran, find out what your rights and services are.
That's right. Thank you for that. You're right. Absolutely. There's home loans, down payment assistance. If you need a copy of your discharge papers, these folks can help you. You definitely want to make a call and connect. With that, we have to move to a vote on this item. So I would like to go to roll call, please.
Ortega?
Aye.
Reinhart?
Aye.
Jean?
Aye.
Fratham?
Aye.
Moran?
Aye.
And Martinson?
Aye. We're going to go to County Connections. County Manager O'Connor.
Thanks, Madam Chair. Commissioners, I'll start with an update from last week. Last Tuesday, I gave you an update on the issue with our electronic payment vendor and property taxes and where things were at. You did receive an email update from Deputy County Manager Karen Francois, who has been definitely leading our team. I would call it an incident management team. We didn't formalize it that way, but it reminds us of some days gone by recently, and we've been coming together on a daily basis. But I want to recap some of the information, and there's a few pieces I can even give since then. The good news is, when I came to you last Tuesday, 99% of payments were actually already back in the accounts of the individuals who had them withdrawn the previous Friday. That was due to quick work of our team and getting to be able to contact our bank, U.S. Bank, on Monday afternoon, and that information flew through. And so we learned mid last week, 99% of the money had been returned by Monday afternoon, 100% of the money by Tuesday had been returned in those accounts. So, first of all, I want to give a shout out to everyone who was a part of the fast response on that part of the work. The first step is dealing with the emergency of getting money back in people's accounts. And that happened rapidly. And we got calls last week acknowledging that into our navigators and lines. People understandably are frustrated trying to understand exactly what happened. But many people actually called, and I will admit in a positive surprise said thank you for the quick response. Thank you for the information that came out. You don't always get a thank you during a tough moment like that. And so I appreciate the grace and patience shown by many of the residents with whom we've connected. The focus was on the emergency response last week of getting money back into bank accounts that had been wired out in different ways. Now there's really kind of three parts to what we're dealing with. The second now is on some what I'll call one-offs. For example, there are a few people who they were able to stop payment before it cleared. They got refunded, so now we need to actually have them pay their property taxes. There's a number of folks like that. There are a couple who think they may have had it double withdrawn from an account. We don't have any record of that. We need to sit with these individuals and walk through their information. But that's an important focus of this week, is you're still playing in the same large dollar amount to that individual and making sure we get things addressed. And of course, we don't want to have someone not pay their property taxes, who was trying to pay their property taxes and got stuck in the middle of this. That's a limited number from the broader list of who we had. And so there's individual work happening with people as we're going through this week. Then the remaining focus will go to some of the issues on the bank overdraft fees. We're working to produce a letter that can be used with banks that may get them just waived immediately. We're dealing with all those pieces of the fallout. The good news is, I would just say from my own view, we're not seeing massive amounts of fallout in many cases here. It seems pretty limited, but it's going to take us a little bit more time to sift through and sort through the final pieces. We had a number last week that was available for anyone. We were using the 8500 number I cited earlier, 651-266-8500. I'm going to use it three times a meeting. It's the new free space on the Ramsey County bingo card. We had a number where people could call if they had an emergency need where they couldn't pay a bill, they couldn't get access to resources, et cetera. We had a process that we set up to be able to respond to that in real time. And we were prepared to come back this week and talk about what that would mean and what we did and everything else. The good news is that was not required in any circumstance. And now we are asking questions of people of what were the impacts to you so that we can fully assess with each individual what they were. We're documenting that information and we're creating an approval process that will come all the way up to my position to then sign off on final approvals of what we can and cannot, et cetera, do. And so I'll keep you posted in the coming weeks. But the team is working diligently on this, on taking in the information. for folks who may have trouble filling out their own form, navigators are working through that with us to make sure they work directly with individuals. If you call us over the phone, if you want to fill it out, we're trying to be as resident focused as possible. The root cause analysis from the vendor was going to be produced and provided to us by the end of today. I can tell you that since I started sitting up here this morning, it has already been produced and has found its way back to our team. They're meeting this afternoon to go through the root cause analysis of what exactly happened here on the vendor side that led to the transaction going forward. I don't want to get, I know a little bit of that right now, and I can tell you it's pretty clear and it's making sense to us. I don't want to speak out of turn when I haven't had a chance to read it yet. So I appreciate your patience on that piece, and you can expect further updates as we go. The one piece I will say, though, definitively right now, is there's no concern of a broader data breach or anything that happened with electronic transmission. It's absolutely limited to what we knew last week, and that's always a really important piece right now. There are no collateral data impacts or concerns that are out there. The website has been updated with the information you all received last week. We went back to the media outlets that had written stories so that they were aware of the updates. We never seemed to get the front page story on the follow-up piece to it, but people were made aware. And then every individual impacted received a second note from us with that updated information along the way as well. So we're trying to be really clear in our communication. And I'll just end with a thank you. It takes a lot of people and a lot of hours to address these issues, and that's actually one of the pieces here is tracking that information. So at some point, I'll actually come back and tell you how much time and money was spent here in the addressing this piece to it. I mean, there was a lot of folks last week, but there's been a full team that's been meeting. Some of those folks are here today. It involves information services. It involves our property tax area. It involves folks out of my office. It involves our communications team. It involves others, the Navigator Services group, and I missed others. And I apologize if I did. It's just kind of how it goes when you do it on the fly. But a lot of folks came together, and I appreciate the recognition of the reputational risks to the county in this moment in time. I don't think it's an understatement to say that in the past decade of my time working here, this one ranks as high as anything in terms of we recognize the importance of collecting property taxes in a safe and secure and reliable manner. And getting this one fixed as quickly as possible and correctly is of the utmost importance to our work. And then following these things through all the way to the end is important. For those of us who have had bank withdrawals like this happen in our lives, you know how upending it is. I've experienced it myself, and it took a bank 2 months to even recognize that they'd done it before they were willing to work, and it's challenging stuff, right? And so to be on top of it and stay on top through the end is a really big deal, and I appreciate the work that's gone in from our full team. Madam Chair, I'll pause in case there are any questions on this particular topic.
Yeah, thank you, County Manager, Commissioner Reinhart.
What I'm wondering about is the potential for harm to credit ratings. So we have a letter that they can take to a bank. Is there something that we can do if there's something that hasn't, you know, that didn't get paid because it was supposed to? Can we notify the agencies? I'm not sure if there's any way to do that, but or maybe they get a letter that actually that they can put in if there's something that shows up on their credit rating.
Madam Chair, Commissioner Reinhart, thanks for the question. I'm going to try to be as clear as I can on the things I know and don't know, and part of this ranks into a gray area where I don't have all the answers, so I'll give you the best answer I've got right now. Our team did discuss this very topic yesterday. At least one resident has called asking questions about this, not saying I've had harm to my credit rating, but I'm concerned if that were to happen, you know, how would we address it? The letter, we know the banks where the transactions occurred, and so therefore we can communicate directly with the banks. And part of providing a letter is not only on the potential of the overdraft fees, but it's also so that they could share that information with rating agencies and address any potential concerns you're talking about. I've not gone through this before. I don't have all the mechanics. County Attorney's Office is helping work with our team on what a letter would look like. But that's the intent, is to try to address that issue if there is an issue for anyone that has occurred.
Thank you. That makes sense to me.
Excellent. Any other questions? Continue.
Thank you. Last Thursday night, there was an event. I know Commissioner Ortega and Commissioner Reinhart were able to join us along with the county attorney as well over at CHS Field to celebrate the first rounds of grants that came out of the Transforming Systems Together work. And it was a wonderful event. It was uplifting. It was a reminder of the power of community coming together with systems leaders. And it represented 4 years worth of really challenging effort to get to the point that we were at. And through that process, you got to see the optimism in the room when you continue to lean in and change the way you think about and do work together. We saw different people being a part of working within our county systems and next to our county systems that have not always maybe felt welcomed at the table or known how to get to the table. Director Givens did a great job kind of emceeing the event as the host. And I see Haitians here today too, and behind the scenes did a ton of work. And it was a joyous moment in a really long journey. And it's just one moment along the way, but it's important to stop and celebrate those successes and be reminded that we're learning for counties across the country and systems across the United States about how to upend and change the way we do our work together. And so we got a lot of work to continue to do, and we got all sorts of lessons after our first round of doing grants, and we have more focus on upcoming North Stars. There were three original North Stars identified. Children and families, particularly the child welfare system and the way we think about child welfare, was the first North Star, but the other two relate to community corrections and the work happening out of there, and I just completely drew a blank. Mental health services, thank you. When you name three and you start doing the list, it can get dangerous. And those are going to be focuses of the next two grant rounds. And so looking forward to continuing to build on that work as we go forward. I'll pause for just a second in case Commissioner Ortega or Reinhart want to add anything on this topic.
I just want to say, how do you pronounce your name again?
Asia.
You are probably the greatest greeter I ever met. She was there. Come on. I mean, she was just nice job. Thank you.
Yeah, Commissioner.
Well, and it was really a joyous event, and talking about where we came from and how uncertain it all was, and you know, celebrating the moment, but recognizing that there's a lot that still needs to be done. It's the beginning, is really what it comes down to. It's the beginning. But I did appreciate the fact that Danny mentioned that when this was first an idea, and it was put into our budget, and the faith that we all had in the fact that this could work, but we really didn't know exactly how that was going to happen. And of course, right after we did that, COVID hit. And so things were kind of in limbo for a while because we needed to figure out how to get through that, that particular crisis. And so, but I do remember, you know, when we first approved it, and as budget chair and going through it, it's like, I'm not sure I understand this. I know what we want to do. And that was, this board said, we are going to make this happen. And we will count on our partners in the community. There are, I think, 30 members of 18 of the, and others that have helped along the way to make it happen. And so it was just so much fun to be there and saying, and talking to the grant recipients and some of the really cool things that they're doing. It's not just ideas, it's action. And that's, I've said many times, that's what this board is all about. It's about action.
Thanks, thank commissioners. Final update from my end. Workforce Solutions helped host a job fair, Feria de Empleo, for Spanish speakers in partnership with Minnesota United recently. The event was held at Allianz Field. It was extremely successful and connected employers with Spanish-speaking residents. Some of the folks actually at the TST event had been at this event and were talking about how great it was. So I can tell you, it clearly made a difference in our employees who got to participate. Ramsey County showed up strong and had planning support from Workforce Solutions, and the VOSES Employee Resource Group chose to play a role in being a part of this engagement as well. Thanks to the entire ERG and their members for help and input. In particular, we wanted to thank Karen Berg, Lola Soyomukun, Becky Milbrandt, Noe Gates, Chris Emba, Brenda Alba, David Herrera Santa Cruz, Adriana Ace, and many others. And we also had department representation involving HR, Lake Owosso residents, community corrections, and the Emergency Comm Center. And so it was a big deal for connecting Spanish-speaking residents with our organization. There was a lot of interest in Ramsey County and the employment opportunities here. And, you know, I'll just say it's but one step, but Commissioner Ortega's talked a lot of times about not everyone always seeing themselves as wanting to work in a county system and what would that look like. And I'll just call out, I sat next to David at the dinner and he was talking about this and said, like, this felt different to me, you know, like people wanted to come work here. And in part, he said, because people could talk to us in our native tongue and they could see that there were other people speaking Spanish that want to work for the county and were passionate about it. It was uplifting, and I hope it builds toward future events as well. Thanks to everyone for being a part of it.
Excellent. Thanks, County Manager O'Connor. I'm going to go to outside board and committee reports. I'll start with Commissioner Fretham.
Thanks. Not a whole lot for me. Commissioner Reinhardt already mentioned we had the grand reopening of Northeast Youth and Family Services in White Bear Lake, so that was great to be able to go and participate in that. I also serve on the NYFS board. And then finally, some CAPRW work, Community Action Partnership of Ramsey and Washington County. We had a meeting with our board and parent council with the federal office and Head Start representation. We also had our monthly board meeting last week. We are in the process of resubmitting our Head Start grant to continue Head Start services for Ramsey County. And thank you to the board for a letter of support that we gave to CAPRW for that.
Excellent. Thank you, Commissioner Fretham. Commissioner Reinhardt.
The only other thing that I would like to mention, because we've been going through a lot of stuff that we have done this week already, is the Sundays at Landmark program. Go to the website. Our website, I think, has a connection to it as well. This time, I was able to, as a member of that board as well, I was able to do the introduction for the St. Paul Civic Symphony, and it was absolutely wonderful, and it was well attended. But there are so many things that are available to the public, Ballet Tuesdays and you know, the different programs they've got, the Great Pumpkin celebration, I think, coming up this weekend. And so just knowing that it is an asset within our community, and most of the events are free.
Excellent. Good. Thank you, Commissioner Reinhardt. Commissioner Moran.
And how do we find out more about that?
About that's actually, I mean, the website is probably the best way to find out. And if somebody can't find it, have them send. You can send an email message to one of us, or you can probably call 266-8500 and say, hey.
The go-to number.
Yeah, the go-to number, because Landmark Center is owned by Ramsey County, by the residents of Ramsey County, and so I would hope that we would be able to direct them to the right place.
Thank you for that. So a couple of things. I just want to first start off by highlighting the Workforce Innovation Board Connect Day at the River Center, which was an awesome, awesome event. The WIG partnered with the St. Paul Area Chamber on a Career Connect Day. They provided transportation for Ramsey County schools. Let me say that again. We provided transportation for Ramsey County schools to attend the event. Mm-hmm. What an awesome thing to do.
All Ramsey County high schools.
Yeah. The event focused on six industry sectors with over 100 employers. Connected with a couple of thousand students from throughout Ramsey County. And the six industries that they focused on was big business management and administration, ag, food and natural resources, arts, communication and information systems, engineering, manufacturing and technology, health science technology, and human service. It was just a really great day with just young people and you know, job providers there connecting young folks to resources, and which is really important in a time where the cost for education is skyrocketing and young people are coming out in huge debt. You know, that's one pathway, but there's also so many other pathways that a young person can take. And this was a great way of introducing them to that and to those opportunities. Let's see here. I hope this is okay, because I attended the Planned Parenthood celebration last night. And I just want to say, through the changing landscape in reproductive health care over the last year, one thing has remained constant is our commitment, my commitment to reproductive health and freedom. It is important that we continue to strengthen our freedoms in health care. The celebration reaffirmed my commitment, to our community. Planned Parenthood funds are essential to sexual and reproductive health care, medically accurate and inclusive sex education, and a fierce advocacy that we do here in Minnesota. Yeah. I didn't get a chance to attend the County Domestic Abuse Intervention Project yesterday, but my office was represented by Stephen Morganson. Thank you for doing that in my place. I've always been a huge advocate and supporter of that work. And again, I talked early about, I had so many different things going on, but good representation from my office. And last, I just want to talk about I went to the last week, I was out at NACO conference, which is the National Organization of Black County Officials in Charlotte, North Carolina, which is why I could not attend the Transforming Systems Together grantee recognition meet and greet, which I know was an awesome event too. Sometimes you just so stretch. But I was,
yeah, that's true.
But it was really an opportunity for one to be around other Black County commissioners from across the country, and really was insightful to see how different counties across the country are doing their business. Yeah. And there's lots of different models and types and ways that commissioners are connected to their community, connected to the constituency, and how their charges are different, right? But it was confirmation for me, as I am 10 months in, trying to get this thing, around what is a county commissioner? What all do we do and how do we do it? And also for me, how do other people do it? And there are better ways we can do it or not do. But also building relationships, making connections, and looking at the policies and practices that are moving around other counties across this nation was really, really insightful. And learned a lot, built some relationships, and look forward to next year.
Awesome. Thank you, Commissioner Moran. Commissioner Zhang.
Thank you, Chair. Let's see. So, speaking of the event from last Thursday, I was unable to attend that too because I had board duties at CAPRW, the Community Action Partnership. Winona attended on my behalf from my office, and she also said that it was just a great event, meeting a lot of the folks who are doing the work. And I just want to thank the board here for believing that we can change systems together and that we do it together courageously. We might stumble along the way, but we're going to do it because going on the same path of trying the same thing over and over again is, again, insanity, right?
Right.
So I'm just proud of you all for believing in that and also following through on that commitment. And I fully committed to support that work going forward, too. In addition to that, tonight there is a district council meeting, the Payne Phelan Community Council meeting. They are meeting at the Duluth and Case Rec Center. And an important item, the MPCA had sent a notice to my office as well as the St. Paul City Council in Ward 6 to share that Northern Iron is being fined for maybe like 15 years of like air quality violation. Wow. So they fined them about $40,000. They will be meeting with community members to share that report. And also they are going through a permitting process as well. So that would be another issue that my office will be paying attention to. And one that I want to continue to raise around how our air and climate really impacts all of us. And even in the city here where we continue to just have like profound cumulative impacts to our air quality. And then in other good news, our team, shout out to Director Collins and her staff. We met with the Twin Cities Habitat for Humanity around the Heights. It was just a lot of excitement sharing about what our current HRA programs, what we've been doing, hearing from them about what they plan to, what type of programs they plan to roll out at the Heights. And also, just a few weeks ago, they also Twin Cities Habitat announced that they are the proud host and partner of the 2024 Carter Work Project, mm-hmm. and they will launch that at the Heights. That's and great. So what that means is that's going to catalyze a lot of the development there, and they're going to bring in tons of volunteers to help us deliver more than 1,000 housing units, 1,000 jobs, and community green spaces there. And so this is really pushing them to like really speed up their process for to get ready for next year. Yeah. And so I just want to say kudos to our team for asking such great questions, for knowing so our program so well, and for being like such for being able to like articulate our plan around our Economic Competitive Inclusion Plan. Yes, ECI plan. Yes, so I just wanted to say shout out to them for doing such a great job for being willing partners and also listening.
Yeah, yeah. And Commissioner Zhang, on the Carter Work Build, the last time the Twin Cities hosted Jimmy Carter and the Work Build with Habitat was in 2010, and we did 14 houses on the east side, so he's coming back to the east side. This year, President Carter, you probably know, is on hospice. And so he won't be joining the build, but Tricia Yearwood and Garth Brooks will be in his place. So still some star power building houses at the yes. Heights. So really glad to have him back in St. Paul.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Thank you.
Commissioner Ortega.
I was just to say, I read that Jimmy Carter actually got out of hospice.
So oh.
He might show
he
up.
He might come. He is a dedicated worker. I got to build houses with him back then, and he was very sure that we were cutting things straight and measuring well. He was all about the build. So. Excellent. All right. So the other thing I wanted to just say, and I thought Commissioner
Ryan. Madam Chair, just one thing.
Oh, yes, go ahead, please.
I want to move on too, but... Yep. Had a meeting of the every 2 weeks, yeah. the AMC Advisory Committee to the Met Council Governance Commission. We met yesterday. You know, it's a 7-county area. Every county's in a different place, but we're trying to put together a list of potentially what the 7 counties could agree on, and at that point, I will bring it back to this board so we could have a discussion to know what the position of this board would be. And I think that would be true for every county.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you for that, Commissioner Ortega. I wanted to just remind folks that today we have the groundbreaking of our Environmental Service Center this afternoon, and I know I got a postcard in the mail about it, so residents have been invited and informed about that groundbreaking as well. We are going to adjourn this meeting and move downstairs at 10:30. We have a close to public meeting on a proposed settlement with Central Square Technologies down in room 220. And then this afternoon, our workshop is actually a tour over at 555 Cedar in our public health center at 555 Cedar. With that, we are adjourned.
And what time is it?
Regional Water Services launched an ambitious 10-year plan to replace all lead pipes in its service area at no cost to property owners. While lead is not present in water leaving the treatment plant, it can get into drinking water from lead service lines entering a house. St. Paul